Choose any search engine and just type in the word Stanford. The fourth or the fifth result will be the Stanford Prison Experiment. Such is the fame of the experiment conducted in 1971 that even after about half a century, it is still being studied and discussed. Apart from the conspiracy theories that Stanford University or P.G. Zimbardo conducted the U.S. Office of Naval Research funded experiment in the way that it was, or at least blew it out of proportion just to get fame, let us objectively analyze the Stanford Prison Experiment. The Stanford Prison Experiment is an infamous experiment conducted in the basement of Stanford Psychology Department by Dr. Phil Zimbardo and his colleagues, where the basement of the department was converted into a mock prison. 24 university students who volunteered to participate were randomly assigned as guards or prisoners, and they started living the simulation of a prison life. The experiment pertained to social psychology and was designed to test the role of situational factors in determining the behavior of individuals. Craig Haney, Curtis Banks, and P.G. Zimbardo were motivated by the brutality reported among American prison guards. Zimbardo maintained that more than the disposition of the person, it was the actual situation which made the person act the way they do. This became the focus of many studies in sociology and psychology in the coming years following the experiment because of its relevance to our daily lives. Only one more experiment, the Milgram study by Dr. Stanley Milgram, is as famous as the Stanford Prison Experiment in studying human motivations and human behavior. If you would like to delve into that study about how the conflict between obedience to authority and personal conscience plays out in our lives, then a link to that study has been provided in the description. As for our experiment, it was a very carefully planned experiment carried out in a very scientific method. Out of the 75 applicants who applied to the ad, everyone was given diagnostic interviews and personality tests to eliminate candidates with any psychological problems, medical disabilities, or a history of crime or drug abuse. After removing any chances of any sadistic character or any psychopathology in the test subjects, what happened left even the researchers in awe. The participants were randomly assigned the roles of prisoners or guards in a simulated prison environment. The 2 weeks experiment had to be ceased after just 6 days due to increased violence among the participants. Imagine being paid $15 back in 1971, $15 a day for 14 days, but getting arrested at your house and being charged with armed robbery or burglary, handcuffed in full view of people, and drove away with a police car. The de-individuation process had begun. It was not what happened with the prisoners that was so shocking, but what the guards did. When the prisoners arrived at the prison, they were stripped naked, deloused, had all their personal possessions removed and locked away, and were given prison clothes and bedding. They were issued a uniform and referred to by their numbers only. This gave the guards power over the prisoners, and then they started feeling in control while being anonymous. Just guards, not humans. All guards were dressed in identical uniforms of khaki, and they carried a whistle around their neck and a billy club borrowed from the police. The guards also wore special sunglasses to make eye contact with prisoners impossible. All of these aspects gave a truly alienating feel to the participants, to the extent that they actually started believing that they were in a real prison. The experiment was being videotaped and monitored the entire time. The prisoners were given no information about how to react or what to expect, but the guards specifically were told not to use any form of violence whatsoever. The guards, however, were told to maintain the reasonable degree of order to maintain the efficient working of the prison. On only the second day, the prisoners staged a rebellion due to the feeling of imprisonment and the guards then worked out a system of rewards and punishment to manage the prisoners. Within the first 4 days, 3 prisoners were so traumatized that they had to be released. Over the course of the experiment, some of the guards grew tyrannical and oppressive, while a number of prisoners became depressed and disoriented. The experiment team had consulted prison experts to design the prison and its environment, and it even had a room for solitary confinement. Some of the cruel treatment dispensed onto the prisoners by the guards included waking them up at 2:30 a.m., taunting them by insults and petty orders, and being punished with doing push-ups. One of the guards even stepped on the prisoners' backs while they did push-ups. The prisoners too had adopted prison-like behavior after a while. They talked about the prison issues a great deal of the time. They told tales of each other to the guards. They started taking the prison rules very seriously, as though they were there for the prisoners' benefits, and any infringement would spell disaster for all of them. Some even began siding with the guards against prisoners who did not obey the rules. Think about it. Does any of it sound familiar to you? Being told by some self-proclaimed authority to do as they say because it is for your own good? More than the investigation of the reasons for violent and inhumane behavior in prisons, the experiment ended up in providing extraordinary insights into how people interact in society. Were the students designated the role of prisoners under any doubt that they might have been incarcerated for real for someone else's crimes? Why do you think the guards harassed the prisoners? Was it that they were innately cruel persons? Or was it that when allowed to have a power trip, they decided to take the highway on that route? Power intoxication is a well-documented phenomenon, and there are various forms and sources of power. When just normal human beings were dehumanized by being reduced only to numbers, and when innocent students were provided power along with anonymity, the true nature of the evil inside every person manifested itself in a blatant display of authority abuse. Dr. Zimbardo has also written a book by the name of The Lucifer Effect on how good people turn evil, in which he writes in very intricate detail the complete personal account of the events of the summer of 71. It is an exceptionally thoughtful book about how one can synthesize the information gained from the primary and the following researches based on that experiment, and how that knowledge can be used in virtually every aspect of our lives in the contemporary age. The reason why this study went down in the history of psychology and sociology as one of the most famous ones is the sheer audacity of its results. There have been various documentaries made on this experiment, and even movies, because of the implications of its findings. All of us know what happened in Abu Ghraib. It was because of a lack of oversight and viewing the prisoners as non-humans that led the guards to behave in the way that they did. Keep in mind that is an incident that was photographed and then sneaked into the public light. Just imagine what would have gone on in a remote place, in any country on the planet, in a dimly lit room, where no one was there who could have leaked what went on there. We see similar attitudes all over social media these days, where the person commenting some of the worst things one can say to anyone is sitting on a device in an unknown place and does not know anything about the other person. The scenario is even more damning with fake profiles, where even the identity of the abuser is not real, hence providing complete freedom to post anything about virtually anyone. Our system of governance and administration and even business are all shaped like this. Who is a colonel? What is a police officer? And why is there the saying that it is all business or nothing personal? What it means basically is that what is being done to you by me is being done by the official capacity that I hold, and not by me as a person. Is it not how big businesses justify the travesties done by their corporations, that it is the corporate entity actually doing it and not the business owners? At least we believe so. And for our part, want to establish the point that putting labels on people, any sort of label, religious, political, ethnic, social, distorts human personalities and the way they behave with others. For more insights into this topic, we suggest that you watch the detailed account of the actual experiment, as we only had the time to scratch just the surface of this iconic and historic study. There also has been a movie made on it, and you can also try watching that. If you think our conclusion is wrong, please let us know in the comments. Whereas if you think that we did any justice to the experiment, then let us know by giving us a small thumbs up. We shall meet you in the next video. Thank you and goodbye.